You're listening to Neocash Radio, where we discuss the future of money today. In the studio with you, it's JJ.
And Darren.
Bitcoin could be saved by a miner-activated soft fork. Is Wells Fargo a bad actor or just incompetent? Millions lost in CoinDash heist. All this and more on episode 215 here on July 19th, 2017.
In the traditional markets, we have gold up to $1,241. Silver's up to $16.50. Oil is up to $47.09. The Dow is up to 21,640 points. And the 30-year Treasury yield is down to 2.825%. And in the crypto markets, we had a continuing dip this week, but there was a bit of a rebound. But despite the rebound, we have Bitcoin down at $2,278, Litecoin down to $41.43, Ethereum down to $213, and Dash is down to $157.63.
Just a reminder, you can tune in to Neocash Radio every Wednesday night. Don't want to miss a single moment of awesome Neocash content, including special episodes and bonus interviews. Subscribe to our podcast on Google Play Music, iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, YouTube, Podcast Addict, and more. Well, folks, you may have noticed Pedro is not with us today. He's out enjoying a rock show. Well, good for you, Pedro. Starting out with the Bitcoin news, and people are wondering what is going to happen with Bitcoin, Darren, and the news has changed. The Bitcoin saga has taken another twist with the recent support for Bitcoin Improvement Plan 91. The effort to avoid the reckless Bitcoin core plan is led by Bitmain, one of the largest Chinese miners. As of this episode, support for Bitcoin Improvement Plan 91 is around 80% of the required, which is required. Let me explain. This improvement plan is very similar to the original SegWit plan, which is BIP 141, with some exceptions. The activation window has been shortened to 336 blocks, and the consensus requirement has been 80% of the blocks. So basically, they need to have 80% of the last 336 blocks to lock in activation. As of this episode, BIP 91 supporters have claimed 100 of the last 336 blocks. At the current rate of support and 10-minute block average times, the miner-activated soft fork could be locked in within 48 hours. Even if support wavers, there's still plenty of time before the August 1st deadline. So what does this mean for Bitcoin? Well, Bitcoin Core is no longer exclusively in control of Bitcoin's future. The miners have implemented the New York consensus, and SegWit activation will occur on November 15th, followed by 2 megabyte blocks 6 months later. If the lock-in happens before August 1st, this will prevent the activation of the user-activated soft fork and offer stability and continuity in Bitcoin markets. There will be no great hiccup or fragmenting, at least in the foreseeable future. This is good news for Bitcoin. Now, of course, we can't comment on whatever flaws this code might have. Now, SegWit has been criticized as being a code that is potentially buggy. We don't know yet because it hasn't been thoroughly tested.
And it's not very efficient the way it's written. They did it as a soft fork, not a hard fork, and a hard fork would buy you a bit more flexibility.
Well, what do you need to watch out for, the Bitcoin holders out there? Well, if the lock-in happens before August 1st, things ought to proceed as normal. It is advised during this tumultuous period that you hold your coins in a wallet where you control the private keys. In fact, we always advise that you hold your stuff in a wallet that you control and don't leave it sitting on an exchange. Because if the exchange doesn't want to, if something does happen, then the exchange gets to decide what happens with your Bitcoin. And also, try to limit your Bitcoin transactions at least until the dust has settled. This is a period which a lot of different things can happen. And with changeovers, there might be a potential for double spend issues. There might be a potential for some sort of replay attacks. Yeah. So it's really advised that you just try to limit your Bitcoin transactions and keep abreast with what's going on. Check your news sources. And if Neocash can, if we see anything, I will definitely make an effort to tweet it and get it out there on our Twitter feed. So, but really what this means is that the doom and gloom that could have come with the Bitcoin Improvement Plan 148 or the user-activated soft fork, that's not going to happen with this. This is going to circumvent that. The whole point of this is basically that the miners are going to activate SegWit before the deadline date of the user activated soft fork, basically preempting that action. And then the normal SegWit activation occurs November 15th, 6 months later, two megabyte blocks. Now, Darren, what's your thoughts on the 2 megabyte blocks?
Well, I'll believe it when I see it.
If it's coded in, like imagine that it's coded in.
Well, that's close to seeing it if it's actually coded in. If it's coded in, I guess I'll believe it.
Part of the code.
But I wasn't sure if the core team was coding it in or not. But
At this point, the core team is not responsible for BIP 91. This is an effort led by Bitmain and one of their programmers. So
good. I mean, I just don't really trust the Bitcoin core team with the way they've handled this. And all so
well. It's sort of like playing a game of chicken with the miners. Is what we've seen is that the core team wanted SegWit to happen, and they weren't really willing to compromise or give any ground whatsoever. And then when things didn't turn out their way, they introduced the whole "I'm going to drive the car off a cliff."
Right.
And it's like, okay, fine. If we aren't going to drive to where I want to eat, then I'm going to drive off the cliff.
Right.
And the miners are stepping in near the last minute and preventing that car from going off the cliff, because what they would have done is basically eliminated ASICs from the mining pool through the changes in the mining algorithm, and then they would have basically completely changed the way Bitcoin functions by both removing the miners, adding SegWit, and then making the other changes to difficulty and things like that, which of course they would need to do. So it's just basically, I think this is a good outcome, Darren. I'm much more positive about Bitcoin's outlook with this change.
Well, I mean,
pending their lock in.
When Bitcoin started, with the original paper and all, basically it was supposed to be governed by the software people run, right? And as people make different choices, they'll run different software, and that's how the governance of Bitcoin would work. That's the original idea. And honestly, the way Bitcoin's acted, or the way Bitcoin has gone the past year, I actually said, well, that was really interesting. I thought in my head, that's a really interesting idea, but it doesn't seem to quite work.
Right.
That just because, you know, I need results, and this is the results we have, is what Bitcoin's doing or what Bitcoin has done. And so now with this type of change where the miners are growing, getting some fortitude, as they might say.
Some guts.
As they're getting some fortitude, and they're actually branching off and doing their own thing, that's exactly the governance that was envisioned when Bitcoin started. So I think there might actually be some hope for this governance model. And that could, if that's the case, there, you know, that could have astounding consequences. Something I'm very interested in, JJ, is other applications of blockchain.
Sure.
Because, I mean, great, currency, that's a really great application. But, you know, it took forever for this type of advancement to come forward. And it is a mathematical advancement, more or less. And so once this is here, we haven't shaken, there's no way we've shaken out every application of this. And I just look forward to the future where there's more and more applications. I think it's going to have astounding consequences years down the road. It might not be with Bitcoin or on the currency application. There might be some other stuff that we haven't thought of yet.
Right.
That's going to be just groundbreaking. Might not have anything to do with money. I want to see applications that have nothing to do with money.
Right.
Because I just want to see what's possible, you know. And this, so at least we have the Nakamoto governance of Bitcoin. It maybe there's a shed of light that this actually can work and can make improving situations.
Right. Well, so the upside of Bitcoin is very, very much potential and very much real. But is it $500,000 real? Well, John McAfee is in the news again. Of course, you know, this is sensationalism.
Yeah, I read about this, JJ. $500,000, that's, for our listeners, that's $500,000 per coin.
Yes. So he's betting. He's staking a $10 million bet on the price of Bitcoin reaching $500,000 a coin within 3 years. He bet more than that, but as a family-friendly show, we'll let you click through the links to find out more.
Yeah, it's something like he'll eat his hat.
Yes, yeah, similar to that.
Similar to that, but
much more personal.
Yeah, certainly.
He is also starting McAfee Coin, a crowdfunding accelerator. I don't know what much to make of that, and I haven't taken the time to look into it, but good for him. I just have a little bit of a hard time with some of the things he says, because one, they're so hype laden and sensational that I don't know if you're just saying this to get likes and
I don't see a path.
Such.
I mean, wow, 2 megabytes, oh big whoop. You know, it's like I'm saying this as you know, as I'm watching Dash Guild 2 megabytes, I'm all excited about it. But really, you need a long-term plan.
Yes.
This is not something you can just do overnight. It's something you've got to think through and understand the consequences and everything like that. So even with Bitcoin doubling, I think the demand's there. Those blocks are going to fill up in no time.
Right.
Even with SegWit, and with 6 months of still 1 megabyte limit, and SegWit, which gives you a little bit of extra breathing room, that's going to pretty much strongly encourage people to use SegWit transactions. And,
right.
And I would be skeptical of them, as I am skeptical of a lot of things on this show.
Well, here's the one thing about the Lightning Network and SegWit is that as long as everybody gets a chance to so Lightning Network happens, but let's say someone else makes another Lightning Network and of their own, you know, own kind, but it still interfaces sort of like that. And I have a problem with payment channels. I have a problem with the idea that you're going to use a payment channel for your cup of coffee.
I think a payment channel is great for like a subscription, like a subscription that you pay on a per second basis or something like that.
I think
that.
It's great for supply
great.
Lines. When you so a payment channel, which makes sense to me, is like going from you're a vendor and you get suppliers from this other supplier, and there's people to pay along the line, and you just set up a payment channel for that whole line, and then money just flows from one, and then the next person who that driver pays for gas out of the payment channel and things like that. Like, I could see that working, but for the everyday user, I just don't see how a payment channel is going to be the appropriate solution, because they're usually making off one-off transactions, you know, one input, one output type transactions for their small little purchases as they go about their day. You know what I'm saying?
Right,
there?
Right. And yeah, it's
it doesn't seem like a good solution for that. So
I don't see how it retains the privacy that Bitcoin currently has, and I don't see how it retains. It certainly doesn't retain the autonomy
right.
that Bitcoin currently affords.
Right.
It's users.
Well, we'll see what happens. I mean, and the experiment goes on, and there are a lot of other coins, tokens, and chains that you can be a part of, and that is the beauty of all of this, Darren.
Bitcoin ABC.
So late to the game. What is this Bitcoin ABC?
It's Bitcoin ABC. So it's a adjustable block size cap is what that stands for, and it would allow the block size to thing. And I think this is going to be – they're planning this as a user-activated hard fork. And if this actually succeeded, then the cap would immediately go to like 8 megabytes.
Wow!
And it could adjust from there. But anyway, I would say you're right, JJ. It's a little late to the game. Bitcoin XT went to 8 megabytes if it activated,
right?
Which was a couple years ago before really the cap got hit and stayed. Surpassed.
For a history lesson, Bitcoin XT had proposed a solution. It was gaining support from miners, and then all of a sudden, anybody who was running an XT node was suffering from a distributed denial of service attack.
Yes, and so I believe Bitcoin XT used extreme thin blocks, and that was susceptible to a DOS attack.
Well, moving on, just one final note about Bitcoin before we get into some of the other coins. There was a post from Freekeen and a friend of the show, a friend of mine in the show, Ian Freeman, had posted about he was going to shut down the Bitcoin ATM at his local store that he runs on July 31st to protect users from whatever was going to happen with the August 1st
so
thing.
So you're saying that Ian is actually being smart on this one.
Well, that's what I'm saying, yeah.
That's exactly right. That's the smartest thing he can do. I think if anybody's out there that owns an ATM, I think that's a... because basically there's uncertainty when this happens.
Right.
And there's uncertainty, and you're trusting a machine with some kind of coding that wasn't coded to handle this case. So you might as well just shut it down, sort the whole thing out, and then start it back up when the whole thing's shaken out.
Right. So basically, to protect the users as well as to protect himself. Yeah, because, I mean, the user might make off with all your Bitcoin for some flaw that happens, right?
Yeah. So, or he might make off with the extra tokens and they only paid for the one token or something. Maybe the ticker feed gets wrong. You know, there's all kinds of things that could go wrong.
Yeah. So those out there, one final warning to anyone that's running an ATM to definitely consider what's going on with Bitcoin Network and whether or not you're going to have that machine online.
I would say, you know, just take it easy on with Bitcoin while this is all going on.
Yep.
I really hate to give people that advice, but with full blocks and all this crazy stuff happening, it's going to be rough. And, I mean, you mentioned a replay attack early on. That's going to be the most the hardest thing to guard yourself against. If there actually is a fork in the chain where there's two branches that are both being mined, then that would set up a replay attack where you plan to spend the coins in one side of the chain, but you accidentally send both, the coins in both sides of the chain.
Or not only that, but a replay attack is where you go to spend coins on one end, and then someone takes your transaction from that chain and then rebroadcasts it on the other chain to move the coins.
Right, which would only be advantageous money-wise for the person who received it on the one chain to do. But, yeah, so, I mean, I think Bitcoin ABC has replay protection in it, but I'm pretty sure most of these things don't. So there you go.
So just be careful out there with Bitcoin, and not to say Bitcoin's bad. As I said earlier, I think this bodes well for Bitcoin, but in this difficult period, I think you should just be careful. Well, moving on, we have to talk about some Dash news. Darren, and
yes, so Apple approves Dash finally. iPhone users are now able to download and install the Dash wallet and enjoy instant send. So I think this is a Dash wallet that comes from Hash Engineering, and the iStore has approved Dash as a cryptocurrency that can be used in their apps. So finally. And this Dash wallet, it's kind of a big deal because it has instant send capability. Most of the wallets that you can get on Android, except this one from Hash Engineering, don't have any of the special features of Dash built into it. It just basically is piggybacking off of what Bitcoin did. But Hash Engineering did incorporate instant send. I'm not sure about a phone with private send, but my buddy Joel will private send it to himself before to his phone, and then he goes around and does all his purchases, and that's a pretty good privacy.
Yeah,
PGP, pretty good privacy technique.
Yeah.
So that's what's happening. And then this week I'm trying to get the fee on Dash lowered. It's going to take a little bit, but it's coming.
Okay.
It's got to be rolled out in two stages.
So what's it? You're doing another interaction with the GitHub.
I have these pull requests, and I'm probably driving everybody else nuts on it. Actually, I'm only doing a few, so it's not that big a deal. But first, I didn't know what I was doing. I did all kinds of, I did it and I did it again and I did it again, thinking I'm trying to fix my problems, and I did it kind of
confusing
way.
What's it like working with the Dash team in this way?
It's great. So the main thing I'm involved in, my duties is not really pull requests or anything like that, actual coding. I'm just looking at what they're doing and considering how it's set up. And one thing that they've really used me for, which I'm happy they've utilized me for, is probability tables.
Okay.
They're needing probabilities out the rear because basically, when you're trying to think about what an attack is, you're like, well, what's the probability of that attack? And then once you know the probability, you can say, oh, it's going to take 2 million years to pull off that attack.
Sure.
And then you're like, oh, okay, that's not so bad, you know? And that's the main math stuff I've been doing for them, calculating probabilities. And then just writing. You can read the dip one that's on GitHub. So I wrote that, and I had substantial feedback from the lead developer.
Okay.
And some other people too. I mean, there's a lot of people that gave me feedback on it, and so now we have it all ready to go, and it's there, and hopefully it'll be implemented just as it says, which will allow activation of 2 megabytes on Dash on October 15th, And I would expect it to happen not long after that.
Wow. So you're saying that Dash is going to scale their blockchain
this year?
This year.
This year. That's the plan. I mean, it hasn't been tested on the test net.
Right.
And depending on how much time that takes, we could need to push that October 15th back. But that's the plan right now. And we're going like gangbusters trying to get that done.
So to date, I don't know about many chains that have scaled. I do know that Ethereum has increased the gas limit on their blocks, which thus increases the size of the blocks or how much is computed in each block. But other than that, this is the first real scaling that I know about. Other than if you quantify SegWit as scaling, which is a tenuous argument, then Litecoin has scaled slightly.
Yeah, but
other than that, this is great history making news.
I mean, the one thing is that they say they're going to do it when it's time, and it's not something you can do overnight. So it's really nice to know that they're putting all the pieces in place to do this. And another thing, with all this craziness happening with Bitcoin, we don't know what's going to happen. So if Bitcoin goes kaput, let's say, that could happen, then all the demand for Bitcoin services, all the people that are using Bitcoin, might switch to something else. And I think Dash is really in a good position to do that. Of course, they could switch to Litecoin, but I'm just not a fan of SegWit. That's my personal thing. I mean,
it's okay.
I could give you some citations and all that, but I just don't think it's well done. And it's a very complicated fix to very simple. When there's a very complicated fix, when there's a very simple fix that's out there, that's just let the blocks be bigger,
right?
So and you know, it's not a trivial problem to say that make the blocks bigger, right? Because if it was trivial, Dash would just make them a gigabyte overnight, you know, and make the limit a gigabyte overnight, and then we just all walk away, except for doing all that evolution stuff that's trying to get done. But there are some significant hurdles and problems and all that, and I think Dash trying to or throwing special hardware at it is a good idea. And I think,
So the Dash miners just came out. There was Dash ASICs that were released, and they sold out, like, instantly from Antminer.
Yes.
And they're doing it in the Dash X11.
Right.
And so that's great news to see that technology come along with other than, you know, not just Bitcoin anymore.
Right. And we've seen the hash rate double with this new release, new round of ASICs.
How is that affecting the masternodes? They're just going fine. Along. They don't really care what the hash power is.
Yeah, they get the same reward. If for whatever reason people put more masternodes online, which has been happening, then their reward will go down a little bit.
Right.
Because basically it's the same reward split between all the masternodes. So if more people are on, there's a longer queue and you have to wait longer for your payment. But, and if fewer people get on, there'll be more.
You basically
money.
Stand in line for your payment.
Yeah, you stand in line for your payment. So as the line gets longer, you have to stand in line longer.
Right.
And if the line gets shorter, then you're not standing in line as long. And then that actually should encourage more masternodes. So there's a real market going on here. And market solutions tend to be good, I think.
Sure.
At least it allows the number of masternodes to scale as demand so desires, right? You get paid more the fewer they are.
Yeah.
That's the way you want your incentive to be.
Well, earlier this week, I interviewed E.L. Herzog from the Bancorp Protocol Foundation Council. You can tune into that interview on neocashradio.com. I touched on EL's history and how he came up with the Bancor network token and what the Bancor token can do, things like that. And check out the interview for more information on that, neocashradio.com. Well, Darren, you've got another story right
now. So this is a hat tip to the Bitcoin Foundation. I was just sitting at home Friday and got an email from them. I still get emails from the Bitcoin Foundation. So And so this pointed out an article that was basically written by the Bitcoin Foundation that says the foul smell of federal cryptocurrency legislation. That's the title of the article. And just to give you a quick overview of the article, it's claiming that the Uniform Law Commission in the U.S. and has a draft of legislation called the Uniform Regulation of Virtual Currencies Business Act, and this legislation would be modeled after the New York Bit License. In New York, this legislation has had a chilling effect on the fintech industry. That's just the case. And it's kind of interesting that they're called the Uniform Law Commission, and they're pushing a law that's only valid in one state. Right. So really, if they really wanted uniform laws, they would be proposing getting rid of this one law in this one state. But anyway, or maybe they could adopt what New Hampshire has, you know, with its exemption for cryptocurrency users. But as an update to the article I got on Friday, a vote is expected today. That's Wednesday the 19th. That's the day we're recording. This is a vote of the Uniform Law Commission to approve a draft of legislation before heading to Congress. So if they vote yes, it won't be made a law. It will be the Uniform Trade or Law Commission will give their thumbs up to it and then pass it on.
Right.
That's what's going to happen.
And given the lack of understanding most legislators have, or most people have, about cryptocurrency, right, this could be very bad, actually, Darren.
If
this was to get passed through.
Yes, it could. One thing that bugs me is that it's like Bitcoin businesses, and you know, and all the regulations are about what people might call Bitcoin businesses, but it can get kind of confusing if you're a business that accepts Bitcoin.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if you're a coffee shop, you're not a Bitcoin business. You're
no.
a coffee shop.
Right.
I sell consulting services. I'm not a Bitcoin business. I'm a consultant.
Right. Right.
And I just get worried that this language is going to get passed around and people aren't going to really understand what it is. So, but, yeah. Anyway, so it will probably, if it did become law, it would have a chilling effect. But this is the early stages of legislation, so that's something our listeners might want to keep their eye on. It's the Uniform Regulation of Virtual Currencies Business Act. So if you see anything like that going through Congress, you might want to let your Congress critter know what you think about that.
There you go. All right, in other news, CoinDash experiences ICO heist, losses approach $10 million.
And this is, I hate the way these things are named. So we just talked about Dash, which is digital cash, and this is something else.
The CoinDash team had planned an ICO, and despite requests for the contract address in advance, they waited until the last minute to release that information. Well, the contribution address was changed just prior to the launch. The launch went on, and then a realization was made that a scam was afoot. Today is reported that losses are totaling around $10 million as would-be investors continue to send ETH to the fraudulent address. CoinDash is claiming that someone hacked into their WordPress site and changed the address in their ICO post. The website has been shut down, and CoinDash has stated that they intend to send tokens to those contributed while the website was up, but anyone who has contributed after the site was brought down will not be compensated. So this is a case of you could have prevented all of this by giving out your contract address ahead of time, even if you aren't going to launch the contract until X date or X block, right?
Right.
And this is just another poor excuse for how an ICO is handled.
This is crazy,
it's going to have a chilling effect on investors.
Which should,
and it should.
People have gone crazy with this thing. And talking about a chilling effect, we got a story about Storm City coming up.
That's right.
But so what's going on with Wells Fargo?
Well, is Wells Fargo a bad actor or just incompetent? We talked about their last big scandal in episode 173, and about their economic obligations to see the Dakota pipeline built in episode 193. Well, Wells Fargo is looking to quash class action lawsuits brought against them due to their practice of forcing customers to seek relief through secretive non-judicial arbitration processes. This latest scandal involves debt card reordering. If you happen to charge too much on your debit card, Wells Fargo could reorder the transactions to optimize their overdraft fees. Vice provides a good example. Quote, let's say you have $100 in your bank account and you make three purchases, one costing $20, another $30, and the other $110. Under Wells Fargo's account guidelines, the bank can charge you a $35 overdraft fee for taking out more than you have in your account. But by reordering the transactions from highest to lowest, putting the $110 charge first, the bank can charge three separate overdraft fees, one for each attempt to draw insufficient funds. Simply by altering the transaction order, Wells Fargo could make an additional $70. This is pretty rotten, Darren.
Yeah, I mean, my first thought was those shyster. What's the word to say?
That's pretty good. It's German.
Yeah, shyster, I guess.
There you go. Cases against Wells Fargo are happening all across the country, with a California judge ordering the bank to pay back more than $203 million to customers over the deceptive debit card scheme. So that's what's going on. Wells Fargo, once again, they're doing the earlier ones. If you want to click back, you can listen to the episodes. But at one point, they were making accounts for customers that the customers did not want, and then it would help their growth numbers, right? Their metrics.
Right. Yeah,
they were just making false accounts for customers.
Yeah, wonderful.
So,
I mentioned the swarms. Oh, yes. So, JJ, I noticed that there were some changes on the website. Did I see that right, JJ?
What's that, Darren?
Do we have Neocash in Espanol?
Sí.
Sí.
That's right. Neocash Radio website now has a language switcher, and we have Spanish language versions of our posts that are being published, and we're going to catch up as quick as possible. We've hired a friend, Dan, is helping us with that, and I'm really looking forward to getting a Spanish version of all of these things happening. So if you go to neocashradio.com, click you'll see on the upper right-hand side a language switcher, and you can see the Spanish post. Send that to your Spanish friends, your Spanish-speaking friends, and people like that.
Yeah. Spanish or Latin or anything, yeah. Anybody that can read Spanish, send it to them.
Yeah, and at the same point, we are also talking with two fellows about setting up a Portuguese, also translation, as well as version of the show, Darren.
That's exciting because, our listeners might not know. If they've been listening for a while, they do know. But Brazil is one of those countries that have gone through hyperinflation a few times, and they don't seem poised to do it anytime soon again. But they went through it like two or three times in the past couple decades. And just having a Portuguese outlet that can reach Brazil, I think that's cryptocurrency was made for countries like Brazil and also Venezuela. But,
right.
But yeah.
So if you're interested in being a part of the Neocash team as we get multiple languages of Neocash all over the globe, please contact me, jj@neocashradio.com. And I'd love to work together with people, and I'm sure we can make it so that everybody's happy.
So, and then we have the Espanol, so send that to your Venezuelan friends and your Colombian friends.
That's right.
Yeah. We they love Neocash Radio in Colombia, JJ. Is that
excellent.
Right?
Excellent. That's right. Yes, we've actually gotten a lot of downloads from Colombia.
All right. So maybe we'll get more because we got some Spanish there.
All right. Some more news, and this is a sad story here, folks. Parity multi-sig wallet exploit leads to huge losses. Unknown attacks have found a flaw in the Parity multi-sig wallet code and made off with more than 153,000 Ether.
Yeah, so I imagine it's unknown attackers.
Well,
I think they probably understand what the attack is by now, I hope.
Okay.
So go
ahead. You're right.
Yeah.
You're right there. White hat hackers were quick to respond and drained untouched wallets, saving more than 377,000 Ether. Swarm City is among the victims, having their wallet emptied and losing 440,055 Ether. Edgeless Casino and Eternity also had their wallets emptied. I mean, very sad times.
This is rough for
folks.
Me because I had some of those Swarm City's token things.
Well, we had Matt on the show, and we're obviously friends with him regardless
really
of his project.
And I just from my interaction with the people involved in the project, I really do think it's a legitimate project. Like me, I'm skeptical of everything.
Right.
Well, I saw these people firsthand, and I know they're working. They're working very hard for this project and trying to get it launched. And they have got it launched. I mean, the Boardwalk's already out. So,
The exploit is only affecting Parity multi-sig wallets created with version 1.5 or greater. So check your multi-sigs. And please move that out of that multi-sig wallet if you can.
Yeah. So the users that are just using a regular SIG, like a normal address.
Yeah, normal Parity wallets are unaffected by this exploit.
And normal any addresses are fine. It's just the multi-SIG in Parity version 1.5 or greater.
That's right.
Get them out now. And if they have been hacked, which is a possibility, You might want to check if they went to the black hat address or the white hat address. The Storm City Press had a press release that went out with both those addresses.
So. Yeah, well, then we have a link to it on our blog.
Yes.
You can check it out at neocashradio.com. So a couple quick stories and we'll wrap it up here, Darren. Ethereum Metropolis release will delay the mining difficulty bomb. Proposed changes in the upcoming release of Metropolis will look to offset the difficulty cliff programmed into Ethereum's code. The difficulty cliff is meant to segue into Casper proof-of-stake blocks. There's also a good chance that mining rewards will decrease as well. Did you see that news, Darren?
Yes, decrease from 5 per block to 3.
That's right.
And that sounds fine to me, especially with their switching to proof-of-stake. I think this is a little iffy for them, actually. I think this is a new thing. I mean, I guess there is Peercoin that's been around a while doing proof of stake, but
NXT does proof of stake. Yeah, the Waves platform is proof of stake.
I mean, so I guess we do have some evidence that this is a fine way of doing things. But
it's just new, Darren, and you know, like all new things, it's going to be having its own growth challenges and difficulties. And
yeah,
I have confidence that the Ethereum team is full of bright people who are well motivated and living good lives thanks to Ethereum's price.
I do think that is the case.
Yeah.
And we should all think Vitalik and I was going to mention maybe Vitalik since you're listening. You should
since you're listening, like you assume
hey,
he's
we
listening.
We need a hard fork to fix these Swarm City tokens here. Come on.
Okay. Did you hear that, folks? Neocash Radio first. Darren is calling for a hard fork.
Well, that's a reference to the DAO that happened long time ago.
Right.
So I was in favor of the DAO hard fork and all that stuff, but this is kind of the problem you run into. Now we have another hacking, and are you going to fork it again? Of course, there has to be a limit to the
right tongue in cheek, of course.
Yes. So.
Well, one last story. A quick shout out to the Free State Bitcoin Shoppe. Or shop. I guess it's just pronounced shop.
Shop.
Anyway, the Free State Bitcoin Shop has opened, and it's in the coast.
Yeah.
The seacoast of New Hampshire.
It's Steven, right? Steve.
Yes. Steven is there. And their first sale was actually a couple of Bitcoin pins, like lapel pins, or like it just says Bitcoin, free the market, free the world. So congratulations for opening.
Wow.
And now it's a crypto-only store.
I'm looking at this picture here.
There's a lot of wow in this picture.
Yeah, there's these. I got to go there right now.
What is that?
It's the Doges.
You seen Doges?
It's got Doges pillows, and I need to buy those. I should buy those with Doge if he takes Doge.
Well, he does take a lot of different cryptos. His first sale was actually bought two pins using a wallet. Already on her phone, so the first customer was already a big Bitcoin
supporter.
Look,
they have Bitcoin mugs. I got to get in on this.
That's located in Portsmouth, I think.
I hope.
I'm sorry. I should find out.
We should know, but it's.
Let me just click through a little bit further, and it's
in
Portsmouth,
Bitcoin Shop,
New Hampshire, and you can check. It's very close to the shore, so. Just go and check that out if you're in Portsmouth.
And if you're not,
a couple of cool cats are running that place.
Move.
And they did not pay us to advertise.
No, we didn't. No. We're looking for advertisers, but we didn't pay us anything.
No, this is
they're our friend, though.
It's a freebie. Yeah,
we know them.
Yeah,
and well, we know him, and you know, it's a good. I mean,
they're good.
It's
folks.
A nice feel good story. It's like, and then I didn't know he had Doge pillows. Now I have to go.
You have to go.
I have to go. I just have to get
those Doge pillows.
Wow.
Wow. Darren's a huge fan of Doge, if you didn't know. I mean, well, for Neocash Radio in the studio, this is JJ.
Darren.
Neocash Radio, where we discuss the future of money today. Tune in every Wednesday for more Neocash Radio. Coming up tomorrow, I have an interview with the Tokes platform, Michael Wagner and Gabriel. I forgot his other name, but tune in tomorrow.